The second significant amendment which has been effected is as to what would be the test, whether there is a contravention with the fundamental policy of Indian law. It has been clarified that it shall not entail a review on the merits of the dispute. So these two clarificatory amendments have gone a long way in clarifying the position in the Indian statute with respect to the scope of the public policy defense which may be raised. The third significant amendment which has been brought about with respect to section 34 is that the ground of patent illegality has been introduced. Of course, it does not apply to international commercial arbitrations. It is applicable only with respect to domestic awards. This was in fact first conceived in the judgment of Sawpipes. It was criticized because they felt that it had widened the scope of judicial review, but it has now been given statutory sanctity and it has in fact been affirmed in subsequent judgments of the Supreme Court as being a valid ground for setting aside an award. Followed by the 2015 amendments were another set of amendments which have come into force in August 2019, which were introduced pursuant to the high-level committee which was constituted by the Government of India to make further suggestions for legislative amendments. The first, and I will only dwell on the amendment which pertains to Section 34. Section 34 provided under the Principal Act that a person who is objecting to the award must furnish proof of any of the grounds which are listed in 34 for setting aside an award. We found that some high courts and some district courts had got misled and were in fact treating it like an appeal. They were framing issues. They had provided for evidence to be led at the Section 34 stage, and we found that it was a complete misdirection of the words to furnish proof. As a member of the high-level committee, we had recommended that it should be substituted with the words established on the basis of the record of the arbitral tribunal. This has been accepted by the legislature and brought into force by the 2019 Amendment Act. So the proof is only on the basis of the record of the tribunal, and you can't produce any fresh material for setting aside the award. The grounds for setting aside a domestic award are specific, which are enlisted in Section 34 and no further. With respect to the nature of power, there have been a long line of decisions which have been rendered by the Supreme Court to give clarity with respect to the exercise of power under 34. The first decision was of McDermott, where they said it is not an appellate power. It is in the nature of a supervisory jurisdiction. The scope of inquiry is restricted to a consideration whether any of the grounds contained in 34.2, 13.5 or 16.6 are made up for setting aside an award. Subsequently, in the judgment of FISA developers, a two-judge bench had passed a judgment wherein it had said that at the 34 stage, maybe, apart from filing affidavits, you could also cross-examine witnesses, etc. This was diluted by a bench of Justice Nariman and myself in MK Global Services. We said that you can't entertain any fresh material and there's no requirement to record evidence at the 34 stage. In fact, now subsequently a three-judge bench has overruled FISA developers and it has been clarified that you cannot go beyond the record of the tribunal. Apart from this, judicial dicta have framed and evolved certain principles for deciding when an award can be set aside. One is reappreciation of evidence is not permissible by the court under Section 34. The court cannot probe into the mental processes of the arbitrator or speculate as to what impelled the arbitrator to arrive at a particular conclusion. The arbitrator is the master of evidence. It's not open for the court to scrutinize the award as if it was sitting in a bail. The other well-known principles which have been evolved are: one, that if the arbitrator has taken a plausible view, you don't interfere with it. You accept it. If two interpretations are possible, the view taken by the arbitrator is a plausible one, the courts would usually not interfere with the view taken by the arbitrator. However, the arbitrator cannot decide contrary to the terms of the contract or rewrite the contract under the guise of interpretation. If the findings of an arbitrator are contrary to the terms of the contract or in violation of the principles of natural justice or in conflict with the public policy, the court is empowered to set aside the arbitral award. And of course, the upshot of judicial review is to ensure that procedural due process has taken place. The court does not relook at the substantive reasoning on the merits of the dispute. I think in the last 5 years, the Indian courts, the high courts, the Supreme Court have certainly revealed a pro-arbitration approach. It is in very few cases where awards have been set aside, and those are cases where there has been a gross violation of natural justice or some kind of unfairness. As Mr. Datta mentioned a little while ago, in Chennai, there are finance companies which contain a clause. It's not only in Chennai, and why I'm actually mentioning Chennai, there was a case which I dealt with as of yesterday. Finance company has an arbitration clause, appoints, is the sole authority to appoint the arbitrator, and no reasons required. So an award was passed in this case which I was dealing with yesterday, which has been disposed of, so I have mentioned it. It's not sub judice. The arbitrator is appointed by the finance company. He goes ahead, doesn't bother to even ensure that notice is effected on the other party, passes an ex parte award. It's unreasoned, just directs the other party to pay up X amount. This kind of a provision cannot sustain. We set it aside for the asking. There has to be a neutrality in an arbitrator who is an adjudicator. If you are ousting the jurisdiction of courts, it has to be ensured that the process is a fair and transparent one. The arbitrator is not conflicted in either way. If it's a sole arbitrator appointed by one party and who has an interest in the eventual dispute which is resolved, it is certainly a case of conflict of interest, and a single arbitrator being appointed repetitively is a matter which is certainly, to my mind, indicative of conflict of interest. And that is why we passed this judgment in Eastman Perkins, which Mr. Tatar mentioned a little while ago, that one party appointing an arbitrator is an anathema to the principle of neutrality and consensuality, which are the underpinnings of a good, robust arbitration system. These kind of clauses are unsustainable and are liable to be set aside. There was another case which is a reported judgment of the Supreme Court, where the sole arbitrator is an advocate who had drafted the agreement and frames the agreement to appoint himself as a sole arbitrator, and then wears a hat when disputes arise of being the sole arbitrator of such a case. Supreme Court struck it down as being a conflict of interest. So it's only in very extreme cases that the courts have struck down awards for the reasons which I listed in 34. and no further.